also going to analyze some over-the-counter medication labels and discuss some common misconceptions with these. And then also we're going to identify some tips to help keep you safe and also maybe save you a little bit of money while you're shopping around. So over-the-counter medication, known as OTC, or non-prescription medication, these are all terms that refer to medicine that you can buy without a prescription. They are safe and effective when you follow exactly what is described in the label. So that's why I'm here, which is why it's so important, and I'm going to explain how to do so. So the label in general describes, number one, what the medication is supposed to do for you. Number two, who should or shouldn't be taking an over-the-counter medication, and overall, how to use the medication safely. So in 1999, the FDA, or Food and Drug Administration, published the over-the-counter drug facts label. This regulation pushed all companies to kind of follow this exact format, and by May 2002. At this point, there's over 100,000 OTC products that have the same labeling. So it is modeled off of the nutrition facts food label with hopefully simple terms and a nice layout to keep it consistent while you're looking through different products at your local pharmacy. So really, we're going to work through these. At the top, you're going to be seeing the active ingredient and the purpose. So what is the active ingredient? It is the therapeutic substance. It's the part of the medication that's going to get those symptoms taken care of. And you're also going to be able to see the dose here. So that's the amount of the active ingredient in each, which could be a pill, a capsule, a teaspoon, tablespoon, however much that it's described in this area. Following that, you'll see the purpose. So this is the type or category of the medication, or what the medication does for you. As you can see in this example, this, the drug name, the dose, and then the purpose. So it's an antihistamine. We'll go into this a little bit. Next, you'll see the uses. So this is the desirable effect that you're going to want to get from this active ingredient. It's going to indicate what symptoms or illnesses you can expect the medication to treat. And what's most important in this area is to understand that you want to only use products that are going to treat the symptoms you are experiencing. And you'll see how this can get a little hairy with some over-the-counter medications. So this area, possibly the most important area on the label. So just as active ingredients have desirable effects, such as symptom relief, these may also cause side effects that could be less desirable or even unsafe in some patients. So this section is going to tell you how the medication may make you feel, how when it shouldn't be used, what things you shouldn't do while using the medication, when to stop using it, and if you're pregnant or have children around, considerations you want to take. So most importantly, this area is going to alert you of maybe think about when should I talk to my doctor or pharmacist before buying this medication, taking it home, and using it. So for this product, you can see in the example, it says to ask a doctor before using if you have glaucoma, a breathing problem, or trouble urinating due to an enlarged prostate gland. So these are some actually very common diseases people can have, and picking up something for your allergies may actually could be unsafe in some patients. So it's really important to read this area. The next section is the directions. So this is the instructions for the drug's safe use. This is explains exactly how you're supposed to take the medication, not just a little loose recommendation. It's really pushing to how exactly you should use it. So it's important to read this area, because if you don't follow this, you're putting yourself at risk for side effects or even a potential overdose. Really follow them carefully in order to take the right dose at the right time by the right route. The next section is the other information section. So this is just some additional safety and storage instructions So some active ingredients may be damaged by hot or cold temperatures or by humidity, which in Florida is a little hard to avoid. But as you can see in this example, protect from excessive moisture. So, you know, we have our medicine cabinets in our bathrooms, and we always think that's the best place to store our medications. But if you take super hot showers like I do, and it gets warm and foggy in there, you're actually potentially exposing that heat or that moisture into the medication, which could lead for it to be not as effective, potentially, or just break it down a little. And then also in this area, if a prescription, or excuse me, an OTC medication contains a significant amount of either calcium, potassium, or sodium, it would be noted in this area. And finally, the inactive ingredients. So these are parts of the medication that, although they don't play a role in helping it work, they are present. So these are like fillers that used to bind the medication and make the pill shape. Then there's also preservatives to help keep it fresh and keep it as good as it can be for that expiration date that's noted. And usually these have no effects on you, they don't matter, but in some cases, you could actually have an allergy to these. So wheat, milk, soy, corn, food coloring, sometimes I see very specific food coloring allergies and it could happen. So it's just important to review this area, and if you do have any of these allergies, to just take a second note on that. And always want to make sure it's safe for you. So this, now that you have your handout, is actually on there, on your little handout, so you can look. But I want you to think, now that you kind of have an understanding of what each section means, these are some key points I want you to think about every time you head to your pharmacy and say, I'm going to pick up an over-the-counter medication. So when you're looking at the active ingredient section, you want to make sure, okay, this active ingredient, I don't have another medication at home that I'm using, or another one in my hand that is the same. You also want to look and say, okay, well, does the purpose on here match what I want to treat? And that goes into the uses as well. Trying to find a product that's only treating the specific symptoms you're experiencing at that time. Of course, no warnings. Be thinking in your head, is there any reason that I shouldn't be taking this medication? And if there may be, or you're unsure, then should I be calling my doctor or pharmacist before I actually pick this up? And then for the directions, you want to find the correct dose on the package. And as well, just a little side note with liquid medications, if they usually come with a little cup or a spoon or a syringe, you want to always be sure you have the one that actually came with that specific medication, because using your teaspoon at home is not the same as using what it comes with. So you know, we all know how different brands of spoons look completely differently. So you want to be sure that if you are missing that, so say you buy something and you lose that part, that you actually don't just take a kitchen spoon and use it as well. You may either get too little or too much of the medication. So either way, it wouldn't work out in your favor. So now we're going to take a little walk down your OTC aisle. So this is where the interactive . So here are some three popular products. Can anyone tell me what the difference is between these products? Like maybe a commercial, what have you seen? What are they used for? Put you to sleep, yes. Any other idea? And allergies, good, good. Is there anything else different about them? For me, I'm seeing one's a liquid, one's a sleep melt, so that's going to melt in your mouth, and then the other is a normal tablet. So let's take a look at our drug facts labels, and I'm going to zoom into one important section. So here, our active ingredient is diphenhydramine, 25 milligrams, and our purpose is a nighttime sleep aid. So the Unisom, used for sleep. Then we have Benadryl, so the active ingredient, diphenhydramine, 25 milligrams. And our purpose there is an antihistamine, right? And then let's go to that one. So our Z-Quil, diphenhydramine, 50 milligrams, and its purpose is a nighttime sleep aid. What do you think about that? They're all the same, right? Pretty shocking, because you see all these different brands, they're marketed, oh, this one's for your sleep, this one's for your allergy, But in reality, this is the same active ingredient in all these three different brands. So in this situation, it's a sleep aid. This situation, it's for your allergies, but it's the same thing. So it's super important to look at that active ingredient area on the box. All right, how about this? What are some differences here? What do you usually think Tylenol is used for? Headache, pain, good. And what about Midol? Menstrual cramps. So that's for ladies, right? Ladies only for the Midol. And then what about Excedrin? Also for pain. Usually it's popularly known for migraines. So like those splitting headaches, right? So again, let's take another close look. And I'm zooming into that active ingredient. So here we have the acetaminophen 500 milligram pain reliever fever reducer. So you guys are right on point with that. Then we have Midol, acetaminophen 650 milligram pain reliever fever reducer. And then we go to Excedrin, and we see we have acetaminophen 250 milligrams, and then two other products. So we see aspirin, and we see caffeine. So say you're taking a baby aspirin every day, which some of you might be taking, and you decide to take this Excedrin. You just gave yourself more than two more baby aspirins that morning. So that's something to think about, that you know, I'm sure you guys know that aspirin can increase your risk for bleeding or bruising. So taking that extra two dose could actually be dangerous. And then you see caffeine. So 65 milligrams of caffeine is like a pretty strong cup of coffee. So if you have high blood pressure or you already had your daily coffee, after taking this, you might feel a little jittery. Your blood pressure might increase. So it's just something to think about. And if you're treating a headache, why not just use regular, a plain acetaminophen? Because that most likely will take care of your headache. So it's really important that we're thinking this Midol is this like some wonder cramp medication, but guess what? It's just our Tylenol, which acetaminophen is mostly known as. So this is just another great example of why it's so important to read the active ingredient label.
Can you still take your baby aspirin and plus the headache pill?
Yes, with the acetaminophen, yes. That is typically the safest option. So if you are on any medications like blood thinners, Tylenol is the safest option for you to use for pain or headache or fever. We can talk a little more about that later too. All right, so keeping on with acetaminophen, which we all most commonly know as Tylenol, it's actually found in over 600 products. Too much Tylenol, although it is a pretty safe drug, and that's why it's over the counter, it can actually lead to liver damage and even become toxic if you're taking too much every day. So thinking about how many products it's located in, there's a chance you could be taking something and you don't even realize it has Tylenol in it, or acetaminophen. So we want to focus again on that generic name. So I have here listed some FDA recommended maximum doses. So if you are a healthy patient, and you get a prescription for Tylenol, it's recommended that you can take up to 4,000 milligrams a day. If you're a healthy patient and you go to the pharmacy by yourself, it's recommended that you can take 3,000 milligrams a day and buy it over the counter. Why the difference? So if you have a prescription, your doctor knows you're taking this, is monitoring what other medications you're on, your labs, your liver function, so you're being watched. But when you're taking it over the counter, they may not realize it. You may not realize the impact it could be having on your health. So that's why there's that lower, safer maximum. And then patients with liver disease, it's recommended to only have 2,000 milligrams a day. It's really important to only take the acetaminophen in one product daily unless your doctor has recommended that you're allowed to use different products with that. Here's another great point about the acetaminophen. So we'll take the Tylenol brand as an example. So it's coming in regular strength, extra strength, arthritis, pain, and then muscle aches and pain. And as you can see, the doses for each are different, which means that how often you can take them a day is different, because it's meeting, all these over-the-counter products are gonna meet that FDA maximum recommendation. So, here you can take two tablets every 4 to 6 hours. In the 500 milligram strength, you can take 2 tablets every 6 hours. And then in the higher strength, the 650 milligrams, you can take 2 tablets every 8 hours. So just picking up a Tylenol and you're not realizing which brand you have, you may be giving yourself too many doses in a day if you happen to buy the product with the 650 milligrams. So again, look at that active ingredient and watch the dosage strength.
Is that dosage
per tablet? Dose on the bottom is per tablet.
I sat down
and got a calculator.
Quick question. So there are tablets, caplets, gel caps.
Yes.
Are you going to go over that, or is there a difference?
No.
Is one better than another?
So really the claim to fame about the liquid capsule is that it works faster because your body has less to break down. But in general, it's not going to really be any more benefit. It may just start working a little faster for you. So when you're looking at the products price-wise, that's kind of a comparison you can kind of judge and see what you may want.
I'll tell you what, I just saw a gel cap in these things. I'm not joking, but things got to be like that big. I looked at it and I'm like, I can't even swallow that. It is huge as a gel cap. So the sizes, a lot of it just depends on what's comfortable for the patient to swallow. And in fact, if you need liquid, because these get stuck in your throat, you get liquid.
Say you come down with sinus pain, cold, you're not feeling good, so you head to your local pharmacy and you see all these really cool products and you're like, I'm just wondering, do you think these are all safe for you to take right off the bat? Do you see any like brands, like do you know what a lead is? Think like, should I really be taking this? Well, I'll tell you, this one's a little more challenging. So all of those products contain NSAIDs. So NSAIDs are the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So these medications are some that can actually affect your kidney function. Especially in our older patients, we can see fluid retention increase and even shortness of breath. They can increase your risk for bleeding. So as the gentleman asked about the aspirin, taking Advil or ibuprofen, or Aleve and Naproxen, these do increase your risk for having a tendency to have bleeding events. And then if you have stomach ulcers, these medications, when taken over time, can increase your risk for those ulcers to start bleeding or even developing. So this is definitely a class of medications I really want you guys to be wary of when you're into the pharmacy before taking. And if you do decide to take these on your own, if they really should only be taken for about 10 days before you talk to your doctor about, is it safe for you to take these long term? Okay, so say you went to your doctor and you have this really bad viral infection and you have this nasty mucusy cough, but you don't need any antibiotics. So he says, head to your pharmacy and buy Mucinex. It'll help loosen up that phlegm and you'll feel better in no time. And you head to the pharmacy and you see this box. So what symptoms is this gonna treat from the front of the box? Exactly, so it's treating that one symptom, that mucusy cough. But then right next door, you see this really pretty box, and it says Fast Max. Like, it's going to work instant. You're going to feel amazing. Maximum strength. You can take one in the day, one in the night. What are you going to think? You're going to be like, oh, dang. I should probably get that Fast Max one. It's going to make me feel better, right? So let's look a little closer. So like we said, this one, we have one active ingredient, guaifenesin, which is an expectorant, which just means it's going to, like it says, loosen that mucus so you can cough it up and get it out. Then we look at this label. You can even see it's going to be longer. We see in this Fast Max day, there's acetaminophen, there's dextromethorphan, which is a cough suppressant. So we'll think about this in a second. Our guaifenesin at a lower dose, and then we have phenylephrine, which is a nasal decongestion. But we said you only had that nasty mucus. Do we need something for your nose? Your nose is not stuffy. Do we need you to stop coughing? No, you want to get it out. So taking these multi-symptom products is sometimes even defeating what you, your goal, and you wouldn't even realize it. And then in the nighttime, you can see they added that diphenhydramine, which is our sleepy time medication, and you still have the nasal decongestion. So that nighttime pill for you is doesn't even have the product you're looking for. But you would see this box and be like, this one's going to be the best choice, right?
So what is the amount of guaifenesin in those?
So we have 600 in the plain guaifenesin, and then in this one it's 400.
For both, the day and night?
The night has no guaifenesin.
Well, that's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
Even I find that interesting.
It's a shocker. I was looking at this like, oh my goodness. So, as you can see.
Buyer beware.
Exactly.
So you get no expectorant at night and a lower dose than the plain expectorant, which is really what you needed to begin with,
especially at
the daytime. Right.
Yep. Okay. So now we're going to talk about some really common terms we'll see on labels that I want to make sure you guys are really understanding what they're trying to say. So we have this Claritin. It's non-drowsy. You see non-drowsy? This is what it's saying is that this medication contains ingredients that should not make you sleepy. But this doesn't mean it's going to help you stay alert, stay awake, and that's actually a misconception some patients have. They might see non-drowsy and be like, oh, this is going to give me a little energy and take care of my allergies. But that's not the case. And even sometimes, with these allergy medications that are non-drowsy, some patients can be very sensitive and still get drowsy. So it's always a consideration to have in the back of your head, this is still a little allergy pill, and allergy pills are notorious for making you sleepy. Then we have PM. So these are products that contain medication that should make you sleepy. So our slide with the Unisom, the Benadryl, and the ZQL, those all are PM medications. But you may see Advil PM, Tylenol PM, Aleve PM, just all these different pain medications that are adding on that sleepy time part. But if you really only need the sleepy time part, you don't need the pain part. There's a balancing act there. But in general, if you're using these PM medications over the counter before talking to your doctor, there's actually a point in time where this can worsen your insomnia from taking it slow. And in general, some patients, again, are more sensitive or maybe more tolerant. So these PM medications might not even make you sleepy. Some people can take Benadryl and be completely normal, and some people will be knocked out in 5 minutes. So it's just important to keep that in mind as well. And when operating heavy machinery. So then we have the day and night forms, which you kind of went over. So the daytime is going to be free from ingredients that should make you sleepy, and then the nighttime are going to have those ingredients. So I always want to caution you about those multi-symptom medications, and just to realize, in our last example, the medication you were looking for wasn't even in the nighttime pill. All right, and here's a couple more. So all day strong Aleve. So to me, that means 24 hours. It's going to last all day, that extended release form. And although it is extended release, as you can see, all day strong Aleve is actually dosed once every 8 to 12 hours. But then Zyrtec, all day allergy relief, is dosed only once every 24 hours. So it cut off a little. So it's really important that you see that word all day and you're actually not withholding doses that could be helping you, or to be worried that because your Aleve says all day and you take it 3 times a day, it's not okay to take your Zyrtec 3 times a day. Then we have that extra, maximum, ultra strength, all those fancy like words that make you think it's going to be an amazing medication for you. So what is this really saying? It's saying that the product has more active ingredient than the regular version. And in that sense, our Pepcid, for example, which is for heartburn, the regular Pepcid has 10 milligrams, while the extra strength Pepcid has 20 milligrams. So that's 100% more, right? But then if we look at Tylenol that we went through, regular is 325 milligrams, but extra strength is 500 milligrams. So it's a little more than half. That, you know, it's about a half increase. So not all equal in all the products, and you have to really be on the lookout for that. Now I'm going to just talk, hit a couple points about medication safety and costs. So as you have seen just from this short presentation, there are various uses for over-the-counter medications. One generic medication may have multiple brand names, as we've also seen. We really want to focus on the active ingredient and the dosage strength. Many pills and liquids contain other medications, so those multi-symptom medications you really want to pay attention to. Always be wary of them. And then also different brands contain different strength pills. Even if the generic active ingredient is the same, that strength may be different. And then you always want to read the warnings for those interactions and side effects. So some of these OTC medications should not be taken with your prescription medications, which we kind of touched on a little. So if you're on a blood thinner, like Coumadin or Xarelto, Eliquis, which you may be on, taking an NSAID like ibuprofen, and then taking aspirin as well, increases your risk for bleeding and could lead to some adverse events. Other health conditions to consider, just very general. If you have kidney disease, we talked about not using those NSAIDs, because they can lead to water retention, which can have further complications like shortness of breath. Then with liver disease, we want to be wary of the acetaminophen, so all those Tylenol, Midol, Excedrin products. And with heart disease, you want to be wary of not only NSAIDs, but caffeine and pseudoephedrine, which is actually a stimulant, which is typically used when you're all stuffy. It'll dry you up, and you'll feel amazing. It will get your heart going for that. So you want to be wary of that. And then with different mental health disorders, whether that be your family members who have dementia or different psychiatric disorders, taking antihistamines are going to make you sleepy, weary, and there's an increased risk for fall, an increased risk for other side effects like dry mouth and blurry vision, and just things you don't want to experience. So it's always important to keep this in mind. So now we'll talk about something I'm sure is very important to you. Money. So, generic and brand names and store brand names all contain the same active ingredient as we've seen. So these products are identical in their action in our body, and they wouldn't be FDA approved if they weren't considered therapeutically equivalent. So some brand name companies even make their own generics. So they're just endless. It sadly is a little bit of a business sometimes. So I just want to encourage you guys to try generics. I know sometimes we think, well, if it's not the brand, it's not going to work as good, which in some cases that could be. But technically, the FDA has approved these because they are equivalent. So this was supposed to have some animation, but that's okay. I just wanted to kind of point out how in the Zyrtec, we can see for the brand name, for 70 tablets, it's $35. Then we have this at Walmart, the Equate generic brand, $30 for 180 tablets. So you're saving $6 and getting more than double the amount. Same medication. And then if you have a Costco card by chance, you can get a year's worth for $15. I have allergies. I take Zyrtec daily. So that's a huge savings for me and for you. And this is just really illustrating how not only shopping around, but also trying the generic product can save you some major cash. You can go to dinner with that. And then we also have, I'm missing a picture. So this was for Prilosec, or Omeprazole. It was $23 for 42 tablets. Ignore that photo. And then $16 for 42 tablets of the generic. And then from Costco, again, $15 for the same price. So this just illustrates that you can be saving a lot of money and really getting the same relief. And these are things you may take for a long term. Okay, this is your last quiz. We're going to put ourselves in Mr. John's shoes. So John is a 65-year-old male who has an allergic reaction with a rash and itching on his arm. He has these home medications, so lisinopril, which is used for blood pressure, metformin, which is used for diabetes, Unisom, that he takes as needed for his sleep, and a multivitamin daily. He calls his doctor, complaining of this allergic reaction. He doesn't know what's going on. It's really bothering him. And his doctor recommends for him to take over-the-counter Benadryl, the 3 milligrams, and you can't say but by mouth every 6 hours until his symptoms go away. But what do you think John should do? Or just heading straight to the pharmacy? Any ideas of what you think he should do? Talk to his pharmacist, yes. What might you want to ask the pharmacist?
Check any interactions.
Yeah, of course. You can always ask for interactions. Make sure that that recommendation that the doctor made is safe. Maybe you started a new medication recently. You know, wouldn't be that safe. How about asking his pharmacist for the generic of that Benadryl? Right? Because we learned that that generic is actually the diphenhydramine. Then he may check his medicine cabinet and say, let me look at my products that I have now. What are my active ingredients? If he finds out Benadryl is diphenhydramine, does he have another product with diphenhydramine? And then if he does have a product, we'll want to always check the dosage strength of that product to make sure it matches the dosage strength his doctor recommended. So John takes these steps, and he realizes that his Unisom, which we learned about, is the same as Benadryl, which is that diphenhydramine. But he safely uses his Unisom. He takes 2 tablets because the doctor recommends 50 milligrams, and his Unisom is 25 milligrams. And his rash goes away, and he also saves about $6 by not heading back to the pharmacy and using what he had already. So I just want to summarize, overall, you have the key to staying safe is really to reading that drug facts label. And that handout, I think, is an awesome thing to keep with you, make copies of, share with your friends, because it is important, and it's really easy to overlook a lot of these points about the over-the-counter labels. You always want to pay close attention to the active ingredient, the dosage amount, warnings, and follow those directions to a T, unless otherwise instructed by your physician. And then ingestion of these medications can be unsafe or have unwanted side effects. So just be wary about if you take something and you're having a side effect, call, ask, is this normal? Is this okay? Should I stop using this? And then you only want to treat symptoms you are experiencing, which we've touched on many times, and avoid the multi-symptom products if possible. And you may be able to save money by trying out generics, so I definitely promote that. And overall, just always be willing and not shy to ask your local pharmacist for help, or your physician, anyone, before going ahead and making that choice and potentially having a bad reaction to a medication. But that is all I have for you, so I am ready for questions. I know you guys said you came prepared, so I'm ready. Have any questions?
Yeah. I had a question, but I take quite a few vitamins, and multivitamin, and B12, and all the things you think you need. And the doctor did blood work and called in December, and he said, quit taking everything, because my B12 is 3,000 times higher than it should be.
Wow. So I don't know if on social media you guys heard that, but we have a lovely woman here who said that she was taking B12 daily. And she got her labs done and realized it was 3 times the level it needed to be. So, yeah, 3,000. Like, huge, hugely elevated. So sometimes we take those multivitamins every day, but do we really need them? If you get your vitamins checked, you may be good. You may have supplemented enough. You may have a wonderful diet and not need those extra pills. So that's great. That's awesome. Thank you for pointing that out. I think that's a helpful tip.
Are vitamins and other supplements regulated as what you call OTC?
Yeah. So this is a huge conundrum. So with other vitamins, they are not regulated by the FDA typically. So say you get a vitamin and it says it's going to have 100 milligrams of X vitamin. It may have 5, it may have 1,000. Is not regulated. You cannot really trust what it is. There are some products, like the USP regulated ones, that I would say are more trustworthy, but also you have to remember that vitamins and supplements, they are drugs too, and, well, they're not technically drugs, but they can affect your other drugs, so there can be interactions, and we're actually going to have a resident talk next month about those, so I would encourage you guys to come.
Okay.
about common herbal supplements and vitamins and how they may be actually affecting other medications or your health in different ways. I'll leave that for her to talk about.
How accurate is the percentage of daily requirement to say 50% or 20% of daily need?
I mean, as long as the dose matches, then I would say that's accurate. Because those are just based off like the dietary recommendations for a healthy person. So those are typically accurate, but what you can't be sure of is how much active ingredient is really in this food when it comes to herbal supplements especially.
I have a question about liquid medications. So some of them look like water. They're that like very runny. Some of them are very thick and syrupy. And so what I've always wondered is, when you drink a thick, syrupy cough medicine, and it seems like there's still half of it left in the cup after you've had it, is that being accounted for when they're giving you the dosage? Or I've always kind of wondered about that, because it seems like you could be way off if you don't get it all out of the cup, or should you? Does that make sense?
So I would say it's not being accounted for. They're really expecting if you hit that line, and that's the dose. So if you're leaving a lot, I mean, what I do is I will add a little water, swish it around, and finish that dose. I wouldn't overestimate, because then you may say, oh, I know some's going to get stuck on the bottom, but then you accidentally put an extra half a dose, and you're just knocking that back. So I would definitely say it's not accounted for. That's an awesome question, and it's true. Some are super runny, and some are really thick. Some of the cough ones can be really thick. But I would just recommend getting some water in there, swishing it around, and getting that full dose.
That's good.
So I would say that expiration dates you should follow, just because that is what's on the packaging. It's best. Now, if you went a day over, are you going to have a terrible reaction? Probably not. But I would say also that expiration dates are pretty conservative, so I don't think they're going to really expire that, exactly on that date. But I would still recommend that you would not use an expired product, just because it could be that one product that did expire today and something wrong happened. So I wouldn't ever want to say to ignore it, but most likely it's not really, raw in on that day.
Usually what happens if you're going beyond the expiration dating is that the potency of that medication is no longer perhaps as potent. Maybe now there's 90% left of that active ingredient, or 80% the longer out you go beyond that dating.
Maybe less effective using it after the expiration date. May not be dangerous, but you really want to be sure of what you're taking. Recommend as long as on your bottle it doesn't say do not shake, which I don't think any over-the-counter medications are that specific, then you can definitely shake it around first, get it all mixed up, especially if you have used it for a while. It may, like you said, clump at the bottom a little, but usually there's ingredients in the medication that keeps it uniform, but it can be altered, especially if humidity messed with it or anything like that. So I think it's totally fine to shake it up first before you pour your dose out for the liquid.
Was that a specific medication? What was the question?
No, it's just in a dark amber bottle.
Oh, medications are in a dark bottle.
Right, and you can't see exactly if it's separated or anything like that. Is it okay to shake it? I would definitely say yes, it's okay
liquid
to shake it.
Suspensions for sure. If something says it's a suspension, it must always be shaken. It's a liquid, it's all soluble in there. Doesn't hurt, but for sure all your suspensions are important.
Which the suspensions would be the really thick, creamy looking one. Kind of like a drug that's like a capsule pounded down and added, or a tablet. So those need to be better shaken.
You also mentioned that when you take liquid, if it's like a teaspoon, you should use a level.
Yes.
Given, but if you usage of people's erasers. Now, could you use a measuring spoon from your kitchen?
No, not a measuring spoon. What you can, exactly, what you can maybe do is go to your local pharmacy and say, hey, I lost this, and they can give you like a syringe to draw it up that they dispense. I'm sure they'd be happy to help you with that. But not even that. Not even the measuring spoon.
I have been diagnosed with Parkinson's disease about 3 years ago, and I want to have you comment on that. It's very difficult to get the right cocktail.
Right.
There's so many different drugs, and keep trying different ones all the time, and you don't know. It's very hard to diagnose.
Right.
I've tried patch, Hazelnut, Cinnamon, right now on Miracoxa.
Yeah, that's a tough one, and you know, way outside the scope of this.
I know you
work closely with your doctor. I've done some talks.
Yeah, right.
For you, but one thing related to over-the-counter medications and Parkinson's would be also with the antihistamines. You know, you do need to be careful because of the side effects of antihistamines may worsen side effects of your medications and things. So anytime you are buying something, especially if they're going to contain an antihistamine, I would think that's one of the most areas that you need to ask about each time, either the pharmacist or your physician. And Parkinson's is a very challenging condition. We have some excellent neurologists in town. There are some new medications that have come out, but it becomes such a trial and balancing. It is hard. You're doing the right thing because I know you go to the Parkinson's support group. Exercising, anything you can do to continue to be active and get therapy is very beneficial as well.